Bless them all, bless them all, the long and the short and the tall. Bless all the sergeants and WO1s. Bless all the corporals and their thinking sons, 'cause we're saying goodbye to them all. As back to their billets they crawl, you'll get no promotion this side of the ocean, so cheer up, my lads, bless them all.
Bless them all.
Gonna hang out the washing on the Siegfried line. Have you any dirty washing, mother dear? We're gonna hang out the washing on the Siegfried line, 'cause the washing day is here. Weather, the weather may be wet or fine, we'll just rub along without a care. We're gonna hang washing on the Siegfried line, if the Siegfried line's still there. Good night, Sergeant Major. Tuck me in my little wooden bed. We all love you, Sergeant Major. When we hear you bawling, show a leg. Don't forget to wake me in the morning and bring me round a nice hot cup of tea. Good night, Sergeant Major. Sergeant Major, be a mother to me. Kiss me good night, Sergeant Major. Tuck me in my little wooden bed. We all love you, Sergeant Major. When we hear you bawling, show a leg. Don't forget to wake me
everyone. I don't know why I'm echoing like that. Maybe Christine needs to mute. Just quickly, welcome to the Friends of Wartime virtual talk. We're going to wait for a couple more people to pop in. We have one more song to hear to set the tone, and then I will introduce our guest.
We'll meet again, don't know where. Don't know when, but I know we'll meet again. do till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. So will you please say hello to the folks that I know? Tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing.
Welcome, everyone. I'm Barbara Dennison. I represent the Friends of Fort Hunter for this virtual talk that we're very pleased to bring you this evening. And thank you, Christine Royce, for sharing the music. As the daughter of a British World War II veteran, I certainly grew up hearing Vera Lynn. So thank you for that. Walked down, you know, my childhood memory lanes. We are delighted to welcome you this evening. I want to give you a couple pieces of information. If you have any questions throughout the talk, please put them in the chat at the bottom and we'll get to those at the end as time permits. I want to tell you about our upcoming talk on November 3rd, which will be on The Civil War Soldier by Ben Myers. And again, it's free and you just register at the Fort Hunter website or the Facebook page, and that's Wednesday, November 3rd. And the Fort Hunter website is in the chat if you don't know it, and I'll put it there again at the end. We're delighted this evening to bring you Rodney Ross, who's a Harrisburg native. He attended Forney Elementary, Edison Junior High, and John Harris High, and he is a 1962 Shippensburg State Teachers College graduate, of course now Shippensburg University, and he earned a master's and a doctorate at Penn State. He taught 7 years at Harrisburg School District and 47 years at Harrisburg Area Community College and has authored numerous academic articles, book reviews, encyclopedia entries, and now this book, Harrisburg in World War II, which is out, and he is going to share his thoughts on Harrisburg's role in World War II, particularly the idea of, you know, the trials of life on the home front during this period when things were going on overseas, but certainly there was a great military presence in Harrisburg. So I'll turn it over to Rodney Ross.
Thank you very much, Barb. It's a pleasure to speak for the Friends of Fort Hunter. I thank Barb Dennison for the invitation, and I'm grateful for the arrangements made by Michelle McCann and Carter Johnson and also Nancy Gates. And my daughter Christine's assistance is indispensable. In March of 1942, 3 months after Pearl Harbor was attacked by the Japanese, Lieutenant Donald Ross led elements of the 104th Cavalry Regiment into Harrisburg on a practice drill. They were seeking emergency enemy parachutists. The drill was a success. The exercise pleased officials, and all violent installations in Harrisburg were secured. I always like to start my presentation with this exercise by Lieutenant Ross for three reasons. First of all, show the people in Harrisburg, right after Pearl Harbor, were concerned about foreign as well as domestic threats. At the same time, it gives some idea how people in Harrisburg and authorities also responded and reacted and acted on the threat. And then thirdly, Lieutenant Donald Ross was my uncle. This introduces a personal note into my research and writing, because as I did research, I came in contact with old school teachers I had, and Edison and also John Harris that helped the war effort. I came in contact with colleagues that I had at Camp Curtin when I started teaching there in 1962. And also I came in contact with relatives. My Uncle Don, my Uncle Howard served in the Marines, and my father was a Harrisburg cop. And of course he had a lot of problems to deal with as far as the city of Harrisburg was concerned. The war's impact on Harrisburg is a theme of this presentation. Out of the blue, this attack against the United States shook up Harrisburg. It was a jolt, surprise. It was sudden. Harrisburg now realized that they were menaced in an unsafe world by, of course, outside dangers. Their lives were interrupted, disrupted, altered, and inconvenienced. I have about 6 or 7 topics I'd like to touch on. And the first one would be this. Throughout the war between 1941 and 1945, there was a spirited cooperation, in fact, teamwork, between federal and city authorities. This was seeing how local authorities, through city and also county draft boards, actually conscripted men to raise an army. Now, the pictures you see right now are actually recruits that have rushed to the Market Street recruiting office after Pearl Harbor. They're volunteers. The one area, like I said, spirit of cooperation was raising an army between, like I said, federal and local authorities. Also, federal and local authorities cooperated with came to internal security after Pearl Harbor. Railway guards were posted at very important suspected railroad bridges. And also recognized they were posted at utilities, such as Pennsylvania Power and Light, and also at more industries like Harrisburg Steel. At the same time, you're moving to security, you're going to find that alien residents were rounded up in Harrisburg. German, Italian, Romanian, and Japanese. Some Japanese visiting Harrisburg were actually arrested by authorities and later released. These were young Japanese Americans in Harrisburg for legitimate reasons. They came to Harrisburg because they were sex checkers of baby chickens. Now, before I did my research, I didn't realize we had that kind of profession in the United States, sex checkers for baby chickens. But concerning the Japanese, they were detested. They were dehumanized. And especially in many cases, as rats, monkeys, and also snakes. That's the cartoon illustrates in front of you. In fact, Harrisburg was so upset that outside of Zenmo Moss, the trees that were Japanese trees were renamed Perry after the Pearl Harbor attack. There was also a concern, not just in Harrisburg, but nationwide, about Nazi sympathizers, right-wing groups. A lady in the Harrisburg Theater saw a short subject called On Guard. It showed the Nazi bun in encampments in New Jersey, also a rally in New York. And when she walked out, she said, is this in the United States or is that in Germany? She couldn't believe those groups existed in the United States in the 1940s. John Wall Carson, in 1940, published Undercover, where he talked about these right-wing groups, which in many cases had Nazi affiliations and also at the same time Nazi sympathies, and of course identified with the Third Reich and Adolf Hitler. Now, the Japanese were detested, the Nazis were feared. There was a much more benign attitude about the Italians. But even when I say that, I'd like you to recognize there were some people in Harrisburg that thought it might be a good idea to change the name of Italian Lake to maybe John Harris Lake or William Penn Lake or Columbus Lake or something like that, because, of course, many detesting Mussolini as fascist regime one of the ending powers against the United States after Pearl Harbor. But of course, Italian Lake remained Italian. In fact, Italian Lake is still Italian, as we know. Civil defense was also part of internal security. City Hall on Walnut Street was sandbagged. Now later on, those sandbags began to deteriorate. They weren't maintained, and sand spilled into the street. And of course, the sandbags were then taken away when there was no fear of any kind of air attack. But you can see Lieutenant Ross and his wife and child. They were responsible for, of course, that drill that made Harrisburg secure in March of 1942. And there also you see two kids. And this might be staged during an air raid drill, somebody many course into a trash can during, like I said, the air raid drill. Or air raid alert. The next picture you're going to see would be Marcus Square, empty during, of course, an air raid alert. And to the right, again, concerning internal security, which was related to, of course, air raid defense where women volunteered in large numbers. You can see the woman to the right, to my right, right above the cat, she has Hitlerite facial features, suggesting you have to watch who you talk to and watch what you say when you talk to those individuals, because you could be giving away vital military information. I didn't realize this until I started doing research for this book, but Harrisburg had a zoo, and Harrisburg Zoo was located at Wildwood Park, and that Wildwood Zoo contained animals that after Pearl Harbor would be shot in case Harrisburg experienced an air raid. The fear was this, that the chaos of an air attack, it might be possible the animals could become uncaged and, of course, become a danger to the public. But I think later when the idea was dropped, there was talk about relocating those animals, on some island of Susquehanna. But I think they remained in place. But, of course, later that zoo closed down sometime after World War II. Now, during these precautions taken concerning air defense, the city distributed sand the same was to be used, to denounce incendiaries in case Harrisburg came under a firebomb attack. And two women complained, and they maintained the sand they received was not sufficient. They thought the sand was to bury corpses and not to put out, of course, firebombs. Now, another area of spirited cooperation between local and national authorities, the federal government put in rationing and also pricing programs. And these were done to conserve scarce commodities and also control the cost of living. And this cut down on traffic in Harrisburg. As you can see, very little traffic on the Market Street Bridge. And some folks from Mechanicsburg used, of course, an older means of transportation that came to Harrisburg, as you can see in that photograph, of vile horse and buggy. Also, to save electricity, no lights on Christmas streets. And the cartoon that you see with the swastika, you know, points out that if you violate rationing regulations, or violate pricing restrictions and regulations, you are doing, of course, the enemy, Germany, a service. You're only helping, of course, the Axis. A Gallup poll was taken, and the Gallup poll indicated that 45% of American workers throughout the United States I drove cars to work. Three-fourths of them said they could get to work by some other means if necessary. Public health was also an area of spirited cooperation between the federal government and local authorities. A major concern was combating disease epidemics. So efforts were made to prevent disease, to control disease that broke out, and of course to eliminate it. And there were concerns about early on tuberculosis in particular. Harrisburg had experienced a number of epidemics. And in 1918, at the tail end of World War I in October, right before the war ended, during the Spanish flu, within Pennsylvania, close to 40,000 Pennsylvanians lost their lives from that Spanish flu in 1 month. And a large number, of course, died in Harrisburg. So like I said, Harrisburg was very much public health conscious. Second topic concerns mobilization. And here again, there's concurrence between federal authorities, the Roosevelt administration, and also local officials. Residents came out and stepped up. I mean, Harrisburgers really did their bit. This was a total war. That's how it was promoted by FDR. And civilians were expected to do their bit, to sacrifice, to contribute, to aid the war effort in some way. Municipal offices promoted war programs. Churches did the same. Churches had patriotic sermons and patriotic prayers. They fed soldiers. They aided the Red Cross. And for mothers that lost their children in the war, they carried out Gold War services, Gold Star services, as you can see right here in this program. This program comes from the Park Street Church. It's on Park and Market on the hill. And it's a program for the Jacobies who lost their son, Kenneth. And I remember the child visiting that family many times because the Jacobies are relatives of me on my mother's side. And Kenny was killed in Italy in 1943. schools on all levels also made a contribution, both public and private. And as you can see with the illustration of the images, the Edison girls collect stockings for salvage, Camp Curtin girls collect keys, and Downey children buy war stamps. But like I said, kids patched in. By the way, women could not wear silk stockings during World War II because silk was in great demand. Stockings became nylon. And at the same time, when stockings were not available, women artificially gave the impression of having stockings by painting their legs. And that was a commodity sold in Harrisburg in stores, paint for your leg to give the impression you were wearing stockings. Clubs pitched in to the common endeavor. And so many in Harrisburg, I'll just mention a few. The Chamber of Commerce did yeoman work. The Rotary Club, the Civic Club, veterans posts also were quite active. Hotels sponsored wartime activities. I'm talking about the Harrisburg, which I think belongs to the Fulton Bank, and also the Penn Harris. That was on 3rd and Walnut Streets, where you now have Strawberry Square, and the court located right across from the White Steps. White Steps would take you up to the Capitol Complex. Industries were quite active. In fact, Harrisburg was a hub, a major center, as far as industrial activity was concerned. And there are just too many firms to mention. I would like to mention Harrisburg Steel. Also like to mention Harrisburg Iron and Steel. Like I said, others could be mentioned. But they won awards because they met production quotas. And they employed women. In fact, women were trained to be welders. Women were trained to be mechanics, gas station attendants, as those two young ladies in that center image are shown. And also, of course, at the same time, there was a police auxiliary of women in Harrisburg. And you see women wearing slacks, in many cases with tight fits, could be distractions. And that cartoon that I'm looking at to the right there points out that the production can be sabotaged by men being distracted by attracting women in slacks. Wearing slacks became a major issue during World War II because some thought it was unseemly and unladylike and very much opposed to it. And that became a controversial issue. Could women be wearing slacks? Women volunteered, they came out in large numbers, they sold and bought bonds, they gave blood, they collected scrap, and at the same time, they also enlisted in the military. As you can see across the board, from my left to my right, women joining the Marines, women there in the middle, that's a P-40 fighter, not a P-10, a P-40 fighter, in Market Square, attempting to attract women to the Women's Army Air Corps. And then to the right, of course, you see waves marching down 2nd Street during the D-Day anniversary in June of 1945. There was a pun from the newspaper that said this: can a woman be happy in the army? Every other woman has a hat just like hers. And a conversation was overheard. During a parade of women, a man complained, first thing you know, they'll take all the girls. A woman responded, they've already taken all the men. The United States Harrisburg had six venues and a river barge that facilitated the United Service Organizations, USOs. And they were quite active in Harrisburg. And they attempted to accommodate the military by providing various services. Recreation, entertainment, travel services, bedding, games, sports activities, all kinds of recreation and entertainment. But the idea of this was to create wholesome environment for the soldiers as they, of course, came into Harrisburg. And the images that you see there, the one in front of me to my left, shows a riverboat on the Susquehanna, and of course, young ladies volunteering to socialize with young men on that river barge. To the right, in the Pennsylvania Railroad Station, is a booth set up that provides information to soldiers concerning travel. They might find a good restaurant in Harrisburg, or maybe where, of course, they might find the YMCA, or possibly where, of course, they might find a certain movie theater they're looking for. But like I said, all kinds of directions provided as far as the soldiers are concerned. The other illustration shows, of course, soldiers at the Pennsylvania Railroad Station being catered to by female volunteers. And we may say, like I said, the hours put in by Harrisburg women between 1941 and 1945. Fraternal organizations offered services, the YMCAs, the JCC, their sister organizations did their part, the YWCA, and also the African-American Phillips Wheatley branch. Ordinary people came out for drives. There's an illustration that you'll see that shows a Japanese submarine. Now that's a prop attempting to draw, of course, people to bonds, to a bond rally and purchase bonds. And of course, you can see some landmarks in the background there, the old Senate Theater. If you look closely, I think you also see the Patriot Evening News also located on the square at that particular time. To the right, this is a picture taken of young women right after Pearl Harbor, where they're going to volunteer for the Red Cross. Boy Scouts gathered clothing, tin cans, as you can see in the rubber, collected by the ton, and police gave blood. And you can see the police is coming up here. To the left, and the policeman to the far right is Charles Ross, and that's my father. That's my father. Concerning bonds and women making a sacrifice and purchasing bonds, one woman said this. Her bond purchase came from divorce funds. So we're saving money to divorce her husband, but she said she could bear her husband more than Hitler. So she made the sacrifice, and like I said, used those divorce funds to purchase bonds. Now, during the scrap drive for metal, officials looked for active artillery shells that then burned in Wildwood Park. After World War I, sometime after 1918, but when they were buried after 1918, the burial location was not marked. So they couldn't find these active potentially explosive shells that were still functional, but still could go off. And the articles I read in two newspapers only made two references to this, and nothing as I continued my research up to September of 1945. Now, I'm assuming those active shells are still not buried in Wildwood Park, but I did email the City Hall in Harrisburg, told them about my research and what I found, and asked them if these active shells had been located, diffused, and, of course, then taken away, but they haven't gotten back to me. But it would surprise me if those shells were still up there. I asked the folks at Wildwood that work up there at station, and they said they knew nothing about this. And of course, at one time, I understand that was a dumping ground, a dump or junk was thrown away before Hack was set up there. But again, this is kind of like one of the little mysteries coming out of my research. I guess I better email City Hall again. Maybe I'll email the police and maybe I'll get, of course, an answer. Dogs were volunteered. There was a vet on State Street. His name was Dr. H.C. Kutz, capital K-U-T-Z. He sent 46 dogs for training. Now, this was a national organization called WAGS, capital W-A, capital A, capital G, capital S, or Dogs for Defense. And like I said, beginning in February 1943, this vet sent 46 dogs for training. And you can see some of the dogs that were volunteered in the Harrisburg area. Those Jean's children are volunteering tipping. And they lived on Emerson Drive. I'm not quite sure. It's some kind of township or Lower Paxton Township. And then the dog to the right is Blue Dobie. And he was only discharged from the military. Animals, despite my kind words about these dogs, could be pests. Victory guards were put in to supplement the food supply for Harrisburg residents. And they were endangered by vandals, by thieves, and also by animals. They were invaded by bunnies. And residents had to set live traps to capture them. And of course, the bunnies were then later released outside of Harrisburg. Also, the Victory Gardens were invaded by, or maybe I should say raided by Japanese beetles that were quite destructive, and also by rats. Children volunteered to work these Victory Gardens. And of course, were also in many other voluntary activities. Newspaper boys promoted the sale of stamps, saving stamps to aid the war. And of course, Girl Scouts as well as Boy Scouts were quite active. Another area, another topic, is the yeoman job that was done by newspapers. They did their bit. They reflected the war and provided a public service. Sheets in circulation in Harrisburg during the war, Harrisburg Telegraph, which went out of circulation in 1949. It featured the Evening News, and of course, the Evening News no longer is around, and the Harrisburg Sunday Quarter. And it went out of business in September 1942 and blamed the end of circulation on the war. But if we look at the contents of these newspapers, they contain war news, campaign maps, cartoons, comic strips, and by the way, more people read comic strips than paid attention to the Normandy landings in June of 1944. Also, these letters contain letters to the editor, or these newspapers contain letters to the editor, excuse me. Also, women advice columns. And one expression of advice given pretty regular to girls in Harrisburg was this. The advisors are very much concerned about women having a romantic sickness called uniformitis, being drawn to enlisted men that were in uniform. Also, the letters themselves, I'm sorry, the newspapers themselves, in addition to letters and also women's advice, contain movie reviews, war reference advertisements, casualty reports, and as you can see, a photograph that appeared in the Harrisburg newspaper, these are German troops during the Battle of the Ardennes in December of 1944, passing by the bodies of American troops. I don't see if you can see that clearly, but the American troops have had their shoes removed by the German soldiers as they passed through. And that appeared in, like I said, a Harrisburg newspaper. And apparently, that particular clip there was gotten by a United States news agency, an United States news agency, by a soldier that captured a German photographer or took off a dead German photographer. The United States housed thousands of German and Italian troops in the United States. And many were in what you would call less than secure or not very secure confinement. In fact, some leads have shown to some that gave no inclination of harboring possibly espionage or possibly sabotage inclinations. So they were actually hired over at Carlisle. They worked down at Middletown Air Depot. They also labored in Newtown Gap. One worked at a limited noodle factory. But like I said, they had different lines of employment throughout the United States, throughout Pennsylvania, and throughout the Harrisburg area. Now, if you did take off, and those that, of course, were shown some leniency and given some freedom, were really not hardcore Nazi. Probably conscripts drafted by the Third Reich at the end of the war, with little motivation. But here you can see two of the runaways that were captured by Kalar police. And I just imagine people in Harrisburg had to be a little alarmed about, you know, Germans on the loose, you know, in Harrisburg area itself. Now, newspapers also provided information on rationing, pricing, and also, of course, how to tend to Victory Garden. All kinds of problems in Harrisburg, scarce housing, heavy traffic, crowded sidewalks, as the illustrations will point out. An increase of crime, I should say. Much of the crime itself was juvenile in nature. A high jump in juvenile delinquency. A lot of the delinquency was sex delinquency. Young girls, 14, 15, 16, and 17, attracted to young men in uniform. And the soldiers said they were khaki-wacky, crazy over khaki. There's an alarming jump in venereal disease among these youngsters that alarmed officials in Harrisburg. Explosion of ice took place in Harrisburg. Harrisburg was very much red light. Soldiers flocked to the city. They came in from Indiantown Gap, Middletown, New Cumberland, Mechanicsburg, and also Carlisle. They were idle on Sunday, nothing to do. Harrisburg outlawed Sunday movies. So movie theaters weren't open. That was not a source of entertainment. There was gambling, drinking, drunks on the streets, fights and brawls, murders. There's a Harrisburg policeman pointing to a spot. Somewhere between Front Street and Market Square, where a woman's body was found. She had been raped and murdered by an off-duty Carlisle policeman, or Carlisle soldier, excuse me. And I meant to say that policeman is my father, Charles Ross. But you're going to find prostitution was prevalent. There were head houses in the city. They were raided repeatedly. The repeated arrests, repeated fines, repeated jailings. And social disease became an epidemic. BD was rampant, and Harrisburg had a reputation of being one of the worst cities in the East. Things were so bad as far as crime was concerned that the Harrisburg police could not handle the situation, and MPs were brought in along with the Shore Patrol being naval police. The city had additional problems. It was dirty, unclean streets, uncollected ashes, and a haze and smoke hung over the city of smog. There were industrial accidents, racial tensions, and repeated ration and pricing violations. Aviation became an obsession, another topic. Enthusiasm for the airplane, an infatuation for flying, and a conviction the airplane could win the war by itself. You're going to find that pilots were heroes, and they wrote books. Ted Larson wrote 30 Seconds Over Tokyo, and Lieutenant Tom Harmon published Pilots Also Pray. Tom Harmon was a football hero, played for Michigan, I think the Chicago Bears. And Tom Harmon was the father of Mark Harmon, an actor on SCIS, a very popular TV program that is shown today. Movie theaters did a tremendous job. Downtown theaters for the Lowe's, the Colonial, the Senate, the Rio, the State. On the screen, you saw movies that were patriotic, filled with propaganda. Documentaries were shown, cartoons, newsreels, short subjects. There were stage shows, send-off ceremonies for recruits. Draft board members would speak at those ceremonies. Clergy gave Bibles away. And recruits were reminded of what they were fighting for. Also, theater managers supported various campaigns, bond drives, scrap collections, and also military recruiting. Each week, according to a Gallup poll, nationwide, 90 million persons went to the movies. I would say the movie houses were the most important source of entertainment for Harrisburgers and the people of the United States during World War II. Celebrities appeared in large numbers, 24 altogether. I mean, Hollywood really enlisted to support the war. And to my left, you can see Abbott and Costello here in Harrisburg, the comedy teen here for, of course, a bond drive. And that's, of course, a governor of Pennsylvania. In the middle is Count Basie. He performed at Zembo Mosque and supported bond drives. And to the right, you can see Evelyn Keyes, receiving keys to the city, and she was here to visit the military hospital for bond drives, to entertain troops, to visit military hospitals, and also military training. Like I said, the stars descended on Harrisburg in large numbers. I have a list of the 24 stars, but I don't think I have time to bring them to your attention. But I can, of course, answer those who came here during the question and answer session later on. My final topic concerns the very important role music played. Music during the war reflected life, wartime life on the home front. Residents identified with the lyrics. And the music, of course, provided relief for frail nerves and mental anxieties. I mean, music really lifted spirits. The forces were Harrisburgers, the radio. Harrisburgers listened, and this is true nationwide, to 4 hours of radio each day. Radio competed with the movies. In addition to hearing songs over the radio, you're going to find movies provide musical entertainment, movies like those starring Glenn Miller, Orchestra Mives comes to mind, and also downtown stores like Troop Brothers sold sheet music and also recordings. I have listed there three of the hundreds of movies, or excuse me, songs, hundreds of songs produced by Tin Pan Alley, but I have three. We Met Again, which evoked separation and longing. And there you see the lyrics. I also have a Glenn Miller song, People Like You and Me. That's a call for national unity. And then to the right, I think my favorite song of all time, Have Yourself a Merry Little Christmas, which of course brought to mind the intimate, the familiar, and a harking for times gone by. 1944, that was the holiday song. The year before, in 1943, the holiday song was I'll Be Home for Christmas. And in 1942, of course, a big holiday song sung by Bing Crosby was White Christmas. This completes my presentation. And again, Barb, you've been very generous with the time. I appreciate that. And it's been a pleasure to make this presentation to the friends of Fort Hunter. And I'd be glad to try to answer any questions you might have now.
Thank you so much, Rodney, for all of that interesting information. Each of those topics could be an in-depth conversation in itself. The industry, the role of women, the population explosion and the problems that brought with it. I mean, all of those different things could be, you know, and of course, as I mentioned before, I loved the music. I want to tell people that Rodney's book is available. I think I've asked the person I think who knows the answer, if chat, and see if she sees and answers me. I think it's available or it's not yet. She's just told me. But it will be available at the gift shop at the Fort Hunter Mansion and Museum. I'm sure it's available at many of the local independent bookstores. And of course, your favorite online place to buy books. I just checked. It is in stock there too, if you are an online shopper. So we will definitely be able to guide you in some direction if you choose to purchase and read the book or suggest your local public library that they should have a copy. I know the Capital Area Library District, which is the online version for both Dauphin County and Cumberland County Library. Does not have one yet, but you never know, it might in the future. So I do not see any questions in chat.
I have one question from someone, Barbara, if you want me to just, I'm gonna drop it in the chat.
Yes, go for it.
There, I just put it in the chat.
Ah, yeah, thank you. The question is, that you spoke, Rodney, about federal local government cooperation, but no acknowledgement of the role state officials played. The fact that Harrisburg was a state capital seems like it should have been on high alert. Any comment on the role of the state?
I intentionally excluded any discussion of what the state was doing. This came into play as far as the city government was concerned, because I was under restrictions by the publisher to limit the publication. So that was one thing I didn't consider. But that's a good point. That's really a topic for another book. In fact, you're going to find that the History Press of South Carolina, that's publishing my book, actually has publications out on what states were doing during World War I and World War II. There's also a book out concerning Chester County during World War II. So certainly that question is merited. And state capital, of course, and state departments, offices, and agencies certainly should get their due. What I'm finding out, Barb, is this: virtually nothing's been done about Harrisburg in a period sense in great depth. And I just kind of, like I said, had to limit what I was doing because of the restriction I brought to retention by the publisher. And in fact, I could be overwhelmed. There were so many things that actually had a cut that I did cut because of the restrictions to keep, like I said, the book under 200 pages.
I am familiar personally with those rules that editors impose on you when you're putting a book together. And Christine has kindly told us in chat that you can buy the book directly from the publisher, the History Press, published by Arcadia Publishing. So that information is also in chat for you. I'll go ahead and ask a question. I happen to know that in the first years of the war on global terrorism, from 2002 or so and up to about 2005, Pennsylvania Guard and Reserve Forces were overrepresented in the mortality rate. Because even though we are not the most populous state, we have an overrepresentation of combat guard reserve forces in various branches of the military. Do you know anything about that in terms of World War II, where military mortality and casualty rates, for Pennsylvania units overrepresented, or about the same as the average, or is the data not collected that way for World War II?
I don't have that particular information. I do know that within the area of Harrisburg, 539 casualties, these are KIAs, are recorded.
Yes.
539. Pardon me?
That's very interesting.
Now, I didn't get into the question you're asking, because of course that would take me away from what was taking place on the streets of Harrisburg, which I was concentrating on.
Yes, yes.
But that information is available. Just be a matter of doing some research. There's public records out there. Historians, of course, have done research on that, and that is readily available.
We have a comment on how interesting it is that both volunteerism and crime increased. Seeming that people went in opposite directions. Do you have a comment on that? As if the best and the worst were brought out simultaneously. I added the last part.
Is that a question, Barb?
Well, someone commented that it was interesting that both volunteerism and crime increased during the event, that people went in opposite directions. So I asked if you had a comment on that.
Oh, I'm saying, okay. I see the question now. Okay, I'm very sorry you didn't respond right away.
Technology works great until we have to say it again.
Yeah. Well, I think it's something like we have today concerning this mask issue, and of course what plague we're dealing with right now. No matter what the external circumstances, it just seemed like people do what they want to do, what they think's best for their own immediate interests, and maybe aren't, of course, really affected by something until it hits them, you know. And that's a good question. I wish I would be a better student of psychology and sociology to understand human behavior and human interaction. But even under dire circumstances, local, national emergencies, people just don't cooperate, and like I said, just don't behave themselves. There were people that violated rationing, violated pricing regulations. I didn't mention it, but there were attempts to, of course, get out of the draft. Some folks fled. I did mention, of course, the criminal activity taking place, and ladies of the night, whatever you want to call them, of course, exploited the weaker intentions of course. Those troops that gathered and flocked to Harrisburg. I think that's more a question for psychology and for sociology than for an historian, so I apologize for my ignorance.
No, I thought what you said is great. I would, you know, the great classic Durkheimian theory of anomie that, you know, you take people from smaller communities and bring them together in larger urban settings, and a lot of people came from more rural settings and came into Harrisburg during the war because the military brought them here, or the work or the ancillary activities, or, the call for job or whatever. And, you know, they're taken from the social controls of family and town and community and social structures, and they find this sort of normlessness. And so they go off in all sorts of directions that society does not necessarily think of as good directions, as you mentioned. And then on the other hand, if you have a catastrophic event like a war that brings people together and provides social cohesion, that creates people's, and it brings out their altruism sense, you know, so you're right, you've got two conflicting things going on at the same time. So, good point.
Barb, my daughter just made a good point. There was more volunteering after Pearl Harbor, and it seemed to drop off. The enthusiasm wasn't there. And in my research and writing, I found the drop-off taking place once Allied troops landed in North Africa in November of 1942, then landed in Sicily in 1943, then invaded the Italian homeland. There seemed to be a relaxation, a slacking off at that particular point, that the war, of course, was won. And the extent of voluntary activity, you know, wasn't necessary.
Interesting. I don't see any more questions. And, you know, I join Rodney and Christine, who has been with us and guided all our technology for us from Rodney's end, and Carter and myself from Fort Hunter. Thank you, everybody, for participating. And hopefully we'll see you again in November at our next lecture on November 3rd. Thank you for coming.